In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit. On behalf of the faculty and the trustees and the staff, it's a great joy to welcome all of you to our celebration tonight. I just want to introduce a few people of note. We have with us Father Michael Zimmerman, the Vocation Director for the Archdiocese of Boston. Michael, it's always good to have you with us. We have also Father Stephen LeBlanc, a priest of the diocese, who is at Our Lady's, no, is it Mary, Help of Christian, Mary Immaculate. Thank you, Bill. It's difficult to remember all these places. But we also have some very special people as well. We have Father Monsignor Anthony Frontero, who is from the Diocese of Manchester. He is the pastor of Nick Wencis. So it's great to have you with us, Monsignor. We have also Nick's parents, so it's great to have you. And we rarely get this opportunity to thank parents because of the demographic of the community for the gift of their son to the church. And so I thank you for all that you've done to bring him here and for the support and encouragement that you give him. You should be very proud because we're very proud of him as well. It is a small note that there are very few rectors. We have a little club, and there are those who are rectors and former rectors. We have with us tonight Monsignor Francis Kelly. Monsignor was the rector of the seminary for a number of years. He's a great friend, a great supporter, and just one of the nicest guys I've met, and I've been grateful to have his friendship for these many years. And I welcome you, Francis, and thank you for all that you do for us and for the seminary. And lastly, another rector, former rector, is the presider of tonight's Mass, Bishop John Noonan, the Bishop of Orlando. The bishop, I met the bishop many years ago, my first trip as rector to Florida. You guys were on your spring break. I was working, and I went to visit him, and I was impressed, and I know I'm going to embarrass him, but I was impressed with his holiness, his gentleness, and I remember reading his Episcopal motto is God before me and God with me. And I left my encounter with him realizing, you know what? God is with him and God is before him. And then I did a little reading and I found out that comes from St. Patrick's breastplate. So if you hear a little twinge of an accent, a brogue, he's from Limerick. So just so you know that, it's not your hearing, he is really an Irishman who got transplanted to Miami. He's a priest of Miami, was made the Bishop of Orlando. But most of all, what I was most impressed with was his holiness, his kindness, his gentleness. And when I would say this, I would tell you, it's like the letter to St. Paul to the Corinthians about love. I left his presence thinking, this man is in love with Jesus and is in love with his people. So it is a great joy for me to welcome to this holy house, to introduce you to him and him to you. Bishop John Noonan, welcome, and I hope you come anytime.
On that note, I think I'm going to have Father Kylie preach at my funeral because I'm not sure if I get those kind of remarks every time. But today it's a beautiful day to be with you, young men who are about to receive the ministry of Acolyte. As I said, it's the step, a stepping stone, but it's an important step on your journey to priesthood. So today we join in prayer with your family and all of us here. And it's a pleasure to be here in Weston at St. John the 23rd. A lot of history. I look out there, and when I was growing up, I guess Cardinal Cushing, you know, Cardinal Medeiros, all those kind of things. They were just like, you know, they were up there in another world. I never thought I would ever end up here, but it's a pleasure to be here today and to kind of just reminisce and see how life kind of sometimes change and how blessed we are to be able to do certain things. And it is a really, truly blessing to be able to grant you that gift to be a minister in the Lord's presence. And so, my brothers and sisters, today as we gather in the Lord's name. And so let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, what I have failed to do. Through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who have taught the ministers of your church to seek not to be served, but to serve their brothers and sisters, grant, we pray, that they may be effective in action, gentle in ministry, and constant in prayer. through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The disciples devoted themselves to the teaching of the apostles and to the communal life, to the breaking of the bread and to the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their property and possessions and divide them among all according to each one's need. Every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple area and to breaking bread in their homes. They ate their meals with exultation and sincerity of heart, praising God and enjoying favor with all the people. And every day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. The scepter of your power the Lord will stretch forth from Zion. Rule in the midst of all your foes. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. Yours is princely power in the day of your birth, in holy splendor. Before the day star, like the dew, I have begotten you. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. The Lord has sworn and he will not repent. You are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek.
The Lord be with you.
And with
your spirit. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to the crowds of Jews, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." The Jews quarreled among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" Jesus said to them, "Amen, amen, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you do not have life within you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me, and I have life because of the Father, so also the one who feeds on me will have life because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Unlike your ancestors who ate and still died, whoever eats this bread will live forever." These things he said while teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Those to be instituted in the Ministry of Acolyte, please come forward. Fritz Anacreon for the Archdiocese of Boston.
Present.
Christopher Aubrey for the Diocese of Worcester.
Present.
Giris Azize for the Archdiocese of Boston. Stephen Baruffi for the Archdiocese of Boston.
Present.
Gerald Foley for the Diocese of Brooklyn. Carlos Galeso for the Diocese of Venice. Paul Landi for the Diocese of Beaumont. Marc Morano for the Diocese of Paterson. Thomas Rashid for the Archdiocese of Boston.
Present.
Nicholas Wencis for the Diocese of Manchester.
I think, you know, I don't know what you do up here in the Northeast, but in the South we always applaud, so we should applaud you. But I wanted to make sure you were sitting down before we applauded you, you know, because you were a little nervous, like, but that's okay. We just want to make sure you're okay. I just want to take a few little points from the scripture readings, you know, and just very simple points from the first reading from Acts. You know, teaching, community life, breaking of the bread, and prayer. Four simple things. But kind of important to us in our lives, to all our lives, but especially in the life of a priest. Teaching. You know, we all kind of look upon ourselves when we get ordained, that we know it all, and we have it all together. When I was first ordained, I remember I had to preach at a family mass on a Sunday at the baptism of the Lord. And of course, my opening line to the families and all the little kids, I brought the little kids all up around me, around on the steps, and I said to them, why was Jesus baptized? You know, I'm a theologian now, so I know everything. My little boy in the back of the group put his hand up and simply said these words, because Jesus ran away from home and talked back to his mother. You laugh. I didn't laugh. I was kind of, okay, I'm humbled. And that's what I mean. Sometimes when we teach, we think we have the right answer, but sometimes we don't. We learn, and we need to listen. A few weeks ago, not a few, Catholic Schools Week, I was in a gym with, I don't know how many thousand kids, you know, from the high school. We also had the elementary school, and we had a special needs. And I asked the kids what they were going to do on Sunday. Of course, the answer I wanted was they're going to watch the Super Bowl. A little girl in second grade put her hand up and said, I'm going to mass with my parents. I said, honey, that's the right answer, but that's not the one I want. So when we are to teach the Word of God, we have to be aware that sometimes we're going to hear the answers we don't want to hear, but they're important answers that we do need to hear. So teaching sometimes means we have to listen and to learn over and over again. Community life is kind of misnomer for seminary life, for everything. You know, a rector will tell you, I don't want to hear one more word about community life. But I think community life basically is to live together, yeah. But it also means to know one another. You know, how do we know one another? You know, I have pastors and they know their parishioners. They know them. They'll call them by name. I have one pastor, when you register in his parish, he calls you that night to say that he wants to see you on Sunday at Mass and have a conversation with you. That's the beginning of community life. But there was a bishop in Miami by the name of Bishop Ramon, a Cuban priest who was kicked out of Cuba in 1958 because of Fidel Castro. Agustin Ramon was a beautiful person, became an auxiliary bishop. 1981, we had the Mariel boat lift. And families in Miami were able to go to Havana and bring back some of their families to United States. But in the process of bringing them back, they had to bring other people. These other people, they didn't know who they were, but they ended up that Fidel was empty in his prisons. They were escaped, or they were convicts. And they ended up on the streets of Miami, under bridges and so forth, and a lot of them got arrested. But Agustin Ramon, if you ever go to Miami, there's a little shrine by the hospital, Mercy Hospital, and it's an imitation, an actual replica of the shrine in Cuba. He says Mass there every evening at 8 o'clock, and every Mass is a catechetical Mass. He preaches to the people. Of course, obviously, a lot of these guys ended up going to church there, and he got to know them. They ended up in prison, and he got to know them. And most of them ended up in New Orleans, or in Louisiana, and in Georgia. But he had a group of people that would get together one day a week, and he would write letters to them. Unfortunately, I think after about 6 months in prison, a lot of these rebelled and they took over the prisons in Louisiana, also in Georgia, and took the guards prisoner. This went on for a number of days. Bishop Ramon wanted permission to go there, and the federal government wouldn't give him permission because it was too dangerous. And after 3 weeks, he eventually pleaded again. They let him go to Louisiana, and he went there. And he went there with his rosary beads and a Bible. He walked in, and he went in and said to them simply, "Put down all these weapons. We're going to say the rosary." Within 15 minutes, it was over. They walked out, and the siege was over. A week or two later, he kept petitioning to go to Atlanta, and the same thing happened. And why was he able to do what he did? Because they were part of his community. He knew them, and he still writes to them through this little group of people. When you become priests, it's very important to know all your people. You create community by just knowing the people. Agustin Ramon inspired me in that sense, to always know people, just to say hello and just ask them simple questions. How do you feel? How are things? So community life is something very simple, but gives you a lot of weight in your ministry. Prayer, our breaking of the bread. For me, I think the one who inspires me with breaking of the bread is Cardinal Francis Xavier Van Tuan. He spent 8 years in solitary confinement, And for 8 years, every day at 3 o'clock, he said Mass with a crumb of bread and a little drop of wine on his hand. He had such a desire to break the bread. He had such a desire for the Lord. And I think we have to have that desire too in our hearts. Every time we have to celebrate the Eucharist, a desire to be with the Lord, a desire to pray with the people of the Lord. If we don't have that desire, you know, celebrating the Eucharist is not a job, it's not something we do, but something we celebrate. He celebrated alone for 8 years and prayed with the people of God. Prayer. You know, we have morning prayer, we have evening prayer, we have night prayer. All these kind of prayers, they're helpful. But then there's adoration, meditation, contemplation. And sometimes we don't give ourselves time to think. Not thinking about us, but thinking about what we do. We don't give ourselves time to even meditate on what we are about to do or what we are going to do. I was telling some of the students last time when we went out for dinner, on my way up sometimes on a plane, you know, people want to talk to you and sometimes they don't. And during that time, I just kind of meditated on the readings. And this is what came out. You know, what did I want to say to you? Just to remember, you got to give yourself some time to think and reflect and let the words of the scriptures enrich your mind and heart and life. Sometimes we overwork our minds and we make it an intellectual trip. But sometimes we need to make it part of who we are, our heart and soul. So don't be afraid sometimes to stop and think and listen to yourself. Because God sometimes speaks to us in beautiful ways to remind us. In the gospel, it's John's gospel, the bread of life. You know, most of us get tired of it in July when we have to preach on the bread of life for 4 or 5 Sundays. But it's the bread of life. We eat the body and drink the blood of Jesus. Eating of the apple destroyed the life. But eating the body and blood of Jesus restored the life. And let us, in a sense, live that life of prayer, that we have been restored. We have been given life, a life that is in us, that comes from the living Christ. To reflect a little bit on the guidelines, now that I get down to really telling what you should be doing, let me just share with you what I should say to you. My dear sons in Christ, as people chosen for the ministry of Acolyte, you will have a special role in the church's ministry. The summit and source of the church's life is the Eucharist, which builds up the Christian community and makes it grow. It is your responsibility to assist the priest and deacon in carrying out their ministry, and as special ministers, to give Holy Communion to the faithful at the liturgy and to the sick. Because you are specially called to this ministry, you should strive to live more fully by the Lord's sacrifice and to be molded more perfectly in its likeness. You should seek to understand the deep spiritual meaning of what you do so that you may offer yourselves daily to God as spiritual sacrifices acceptable to Him through Jesus Christ. In performing your ministry, bear in mind that as you share the one bread with your brothers and sisters, so you form one body with them. Show a sincere love for Christ's mystical body, God's holy people, and especially for the weak and the sick. Be obedient to the commandment which the Lord gave to his apostles at the Last Supper. Love one another as I have loved you. Amen.
Let us stand.
God of mercy, through your only Son, you entrusted the bread of life to your church. Bless these, our brothers, who have been chosen for the ministry of Acolyte. Grant them that they may be faithful in the service of your altar, and in giving others the bread of life. May they grow always in faith and love, and so build up your church through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Let us be seated.
Take this vessel with bread for the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service at the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
Take this vessel with bread for the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service at the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
Take this vessel with bread for the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service at the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
Amen. Bless you. Take this vessel with the bread for the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service at the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
Bless you. Thank you. Take this vessel with the bread for the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service at the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
Bless you. Take this vessel with bread for the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service at the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
Bless you. Take this vessel with bread for the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
take this vessel with bread, the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service at the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
Take this vessel with bread for the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service at the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
Bless you. Take this vessel with bread for the celebration of the Eucharist. Make your life worthy of your service at the table of the Lord and of his church.
Amen.
Let us stand.
Lord, as we gather on this day, ever mindful of the blessings you have bestowed upon us, we offer you now our prayers of petition.
For the church throughout the world and for its leaders, especially Francis, our Pope, Sean, our Archbishop, Bishop John Gerald Noonan, may the Lord continue to bless and guide them as they carry out their cross of pastoral care and leadership. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brothers who have been chosen for the ministry of Acolyte, may God give them the grace to serve at the holy altar of God with love and reverence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For strong marriages, faithfulness to religious vows, commitment service to the church by the laity, and many more men answering God's call to the priesthood, especially through formation here at Pope St. John National Seminary. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace throughout the world, especially in Ukraine, Russia, Nicaragua, Nigeria, Cameroon, and for comfort and hope to the people of Turkey and Syria in the aftermath of the earthquake. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have requested us to pray for them, for those intentions in our chapel book of prayer, and for those intentions we bring to the altar of the Lord. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks especially for the gifts you bestow upon us in our life. May our ministry continue to preach and share the gospel through all our lives. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Pray. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty. Holy Father, whose Son chose to wash the disciples' feet, and so set us an example, accept, we pray, the oblation of our service, and grant that offering ourselves a spiritual sacrifice, we may be filled with a spirit of humility and zeal through Christ our Lord. Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Father most holy, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your word to whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. Fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. And so with angels and all the saints, we declare your glory as with one voice we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fountain of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and to minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Sean, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
At our Savior's command, informed by his divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Grace to grant peace in our day. By the help of your mercy, may always be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I leave you, peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grace to grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
God bless you.
God bless you. Thank you, friends.
Pater Cristo, peace be with you. Peace be with you. God bless. Peace. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace. Peace, brothers. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, to your servants whom you have replenished with heavenly food and drink, that for the sake of your glory and for the salvation of believers, they may be found faithful as ministers of the gospel, of the sacraments, and of charity. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
That's it? Just a blessing? Oh, that's easy. You know, there's no announcements or anything like that? No? Oh, wow. I'm really impressed. Bow your heads and pray. Oh, sorry.
Bow down for the blessing.
May God bless you with ever heavenly blessing. Make you always holy and pure in his sight. Pour out in abundance upon the riches of his glory and teach you with words of truth. May you be instructed you in the gospel of salvation and ever endow you with fraternal charity through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.